Thank you, Fred, for your leadership. That was wonderful. If you have your Bibles, I'd like you to look at Acts chapter 2. We'll be looking at verses 37 through 47. And we are grateful for Shane Johnson and his preaching the last 3 weeks. And Shane didn't preach with notes, so you can have in your bulletin today some sermon notes, an outline you can follow along my sermons with. But we appreciate what Shane has preached on about Go Fish, and it's been a good series. And if you read my newsletter article this week, when you receive your newsletter, you see how that fits in with the overall emphasis and direction that we're headed as a church. And so we want to start really focusing on that next week with a new series called Dare You to Move. And that's what that newsletter article is about. So if you want a head start on it, be sure to read it and find out where we're heading and what we need to do. So I encourage you to be back next week as we talk about Dare You to Move. And I'm inviting you to come on a journey with me. But today we want to kind of just pause in between Shane's series and my new series and talk about the 3C triangle. We'll be looking at Acts chapter 2, verses 37 through 47. Now, if you've been looking at the news this week, you remember that Santa Fe College and the University of Florida had their convocations this week. And the leadership gathered the faculty and the students to challenge them to reach new goals and work together to build a successful school year. And that's what convocation means. It means to gather together, to gather together to talk about a common cause. Well, that's what I'm calling today, is a convocation. I'm calling us together today to rally us to our cause and to remind us of our common purpose and goals. We need to review that every once in a while to make sure we're on the same page and we understand exactly where we're headed together. I want us to remember our reason for being. Why are we here? What are we called to do? And so we came up with this 3C triangle of growth that will show us why we're here and what we need to do as a church. The 3C triangle shows us how we can move people into our fellowship and become committed followers of Jesus Christ. And so these are the 3 C's: contact, connections, and consistency. And if we do those 3 C's, we're going to grow as a church. And so that's where this passage comes in as we talk about the first church there in Jerusalem. And we look at Acts chapter 2, verses 40 through 47. And it describes the 3C triangle at work. Now, before we get into our text today, I want to remind us of some key points, basic premises that we agree upon as a church. Because somebody might say, well, preacher, that's a nice little outline, but, you know, it's just an outline. It's just something coming from you, and it's not really from God. So let me just say from the outset, these 4 fundamental truths. First of all, this church is built on the lordship of Jesus Christ. Amen? Amen? Amen. Jesus is Lord. Will you say that with me? Jesus is Lord. So this isn't my church, and it's not your church. Amen. It's our church under the lordship of Jesus Christ. And we need to constantly remind ourselves of that because he's the one that's calling us to action. And then we have to remind ourselves of the Holy Spirit. And that's what Acts chapter 2 is all about. The day of Pentecost, the Holy Spirit was poured out upon the church. Peter got up and he preached boldly. And the Spirit of God moved on the lives of the crowd that was there that day. And 3,000 people got saved. That was a supernatural happening. Amen. Never been done before. And that's why Jesus said, upon this statement, Peter, I will build my church. What did he say? Jesus said, what? That's exactly right. And he also said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. And so upon that statement, and upon the fact that the gates of hell will not prevail against it, Jesus said, I'm going to ascend to my Father, and I'm going to pour out my Spirit upon you, and something's going to happen. Something supernatural is going to happen. It's going to be the power of the Holy Spirit is going to come upon you. So we operate not in the flesh, or in our own intellect or in our own strength. We operate in the power of the Holy Spirit. And we don't talk about that enough, but we need to remind ourselves we are dependent upon the Holy Spirit. And then remind ourselves that we need to pray. God does nothing outside the prayers of His people. And if we're praying for a common goal and a common cause and praying for each other, God can work wonderfully and do mighty things. He did that in this early church, and He can do that in our church. Are you praying? Are you praying together for each other and for this church? Are you asking God to get people saved and baptized? Amen. Are you asking God to show you how you should live as a Christian on a daily basis and how you should invite people to come and be a part of this church? We need to pray those prayers. Amen. We need to do that consciously. And yet, sometimes I find out people are so busy that God is an afterthought, and maybe at the end of the day they say, thank you, God, for getting me through another day. We need more prayer than that. And the early church had corporate prayer. They prayed together. We do that every Wednesday night, and we pray as a church for each other. You know, prayer meetings should be one of the most well-attended services throughout the week, and yet it's one of the puniest attended services. Why is that? Because we don't believe in prayer and in the power of prayer. We need to come together as a church and pray. That's what Wednesday night's all about. Not just Bible study, but corporate prayer together. And then finally, we need to remind ourselves that God uses people. God uses people. And He calls out His Christian leaders to lead, and He calls out His ministers, you're the ministers, to serve Him wherever He's placed you in this world. So let's just get those as our basic premises as we start the service today, okay? So anything I say today, remind yourselves that we are dependent on the Lord Jesus as our Lord, and we depend on the Holy Spirit for our power and strength, and we have to pray together to support one another, and then we need to get out there and do what He's called us to do. Amen. That's what we're basing all this on, okay? So that leads us to our passage today, and we come into this 3C triangle. And the first point in the triangle is contact. Contact. It's base point one. And you'll see it there in the corner. And this is found in Acts chapter 2, verses 37 through 41. Now, I want you to understand, when we talk about contact, we're talking about how we touch people's lives. We reach out to people. We make interaction with people. We have relationships with people. That's what I'm talking about when I say contact. You say, how do you contact people? You might ask yourself that. What do you mean by contact? Well, you contact people through face-to-face conversation. That's one way. You contact people through letters, through email, through text messages. You can call people on the telephone. That's contact, right? You have a variety of ways you can make contacts. But the point is, in order for a church to grow, you got to make contacts. Amen. Numbers are important. Yeah. And the more people you contact, the more opportunity you have as a church to grow. Amen. And so let's just look at this principle behind this. The more people you reach, the more people you retain. The more people you reach, the more people you retain. Now look at this crowd today. Isn't this just the puniest thing you've ever seen? Look at this. How feeble is this? How feeble is it? You say, preacher, you're not supposed to talk like that. You're going to hurt our feelings. Well, listen. Did you contact somebody this week? Did you ask them to come to church with you today? I did my dissertation on this subject, about how churches grow, how stagnated churches grow, how churches get off the plateau and grow, how new churches start and begin and grow, and how old churches can get revived. And you know what I found out of all that study? You know how churches grow? Somebody asks someone else to come to church with them, and they get saved. That's how churches grow. All the studies say the same thing. You could have a huge choir up here, the Brooklyn Tabernacle Choir. You can have them up here singing away every Sunday. And unless you invite somebody to come hear them, they're not going to come. You could have Billy Graham in this pulpit. Maybe God does a miraculous healing in his life, and he could stand up here without his wheelchair, and he could preach every Sunday morning. And guess what? No one's going to come unless you invite them. Okay, we could put it on the marquee. We could put it on the radio and the TV. We can send out flyer after flyer after flyer. But guess what? All that doesn't compare to you talking to somebody you know and inviting them to come with you to church. You have to do it. So I'm asking you, are you doing that? You see, the more people you reach, the more people you retain. So we have to increase our number of contacts. We have to look for ways to touch as many people as possible. We have to find ways to invite people to come in to the church. We have to go to meet people where they are and see how they're doing in their lives, and just sit down with them and listen to them and talk with them. Maybe take them to coffee at Starbucks or Dunkin' Donuts, you know, if you're into donuts. And you just sit with them and talk with them and share with them and just get to be friends with them and make those touches. The more touches you have in people's lives, the more opportunity you have to invite them to come to know Jesus as Lord and Savior. Amen. You know, I read a little comment. Someone put this in my box. I don't even know who did this. It's called "The Man with a Consecrated Car." He couldn't speak before a crowd. He couldn't teach a class. But when he came to Sunday school, he brought the folks in mass. He couldn't sing to save his life. In public, he couldn't pray. But always his jalopy was just crammed on each Lord's day. With all the others whom he had brought, who lived both near and far, and God's work was greatly prospered, for he had a consecrated car. We need people with consecrated cars. Amen. We need people that are willing to invite others to come to Jesus and to come to church so they can hear about Jesus Christ. So the more people you reach, the more people you retain. So what's the scripture say? Notice what happens here. Peter has just finished preaching. The Holy Spirit's been poured out in the church. Peter and the other apostles got up and started speaking. Peter preached his salvation sermon, telling about Jesus whom they had crucified, but God raised from the dead. And here's what happens, verses 37 through 41. When the people heard this, they were cut to the heart and said to Peter and the other apostles, "Brothers, what shall we do?" And Peter replied, "Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ, for forgiveness of sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. The promise is for you and your children and for all who are far off, for all whom the Lord our God will call." With many other words, he warned them and he pleaded with them, "Save yourselves from this corrupt generation." And those who accepted his message were baptized, and about 3,000 were added to their number that day. Now I want you to think about something. Who is he preaching to? This is the season of Passover. This is the season of the festivals. People from all over the Mediterranean area, all over the known world at that time, had come to worship in Jerusalem. They had taken long journeys to be there. They stayed weeks at a time. Some scholars say Jerusalem would surge in numbers up to 100,000 people beyond their normal population from all the people that came in from the other areas of the world. And so Peter and the apostles are praying in the upper room. The Holy Spirit's poured out. And what happens? They go out into the temple area and they start preaching. And now people start coming together. A big crowd. In the early parts of the chapter 2, you can say it names all the different nations they came from. And people are saying, "We don't understand this. We're hearing this message in our own tongue." And Peter stands up and he says, "We're not drunk, as some of you are saying. No, this is the Holy Spirit that the prophet Joel promised would be poured out upon us." Amen. And he starts preaching. Yes. And as he preaches, this huge crowd, who knows how many were there, this huge crowd hears him preach, and Peter gives the gospel message, and the crowd's heart is cut to the quick. And some of them yell out, what do we need to do? What do we need to do? And Peter tells them, you got to repent. You got to believe in the Lord Jesus. You got to be baptized. And then you become part of God's family. And the Bible says that 3,000 of them made that choice. Amen. And got baptized that day. Amen. Now we don't know how many people were there in all the crowd. 3,000 might have just been 10% of maybe 30,000 people. Maybe it was a bigger number than that, percentage-wise, but we don't know. But we do know that a few of them got saved because Peter touched a lot of them. Amen. And that's what I'm talking about. Amen. You can't get numbers of people saved unless you're spreading the gospel to a lot of people. Amen. Now you may say, hey, people may not like me bugging them. That's all right. What's that off your back? I don't want Jesus bugging me when I stand before him. Amen. I don't want him saying, why are you ashamed of me? Amen. I'm ashamed of you now before the Father. And somebody will say, oh, preacher, don't use that guilt trip stuff on us. Hey, that's not my words. That's what Jesus says. Amen. Okay? Amen. He who's ashamed of me, I'll also be ashamed of that person before the Father. Why aren't we inviting people? Are you afraid? What are you afraid of? That they'll say no? That's okay. That's okay. You know, in my life, I've had many, many jobs. Some poverty-level jobs, some better jobs than that. But one of those jobs was to try to sell insurance and other types of things. And guess what? The insurance salesmen always say this. You have to contact so many people in order to get one person to buy your product. Okay? And I forget the exact number of what it is, but it's a huge number. A huge number. Like 100 people you have to contact to get one sale. It's just incredible. And I thought to myself, we don't even ask two or three, and then we wonder why nobody's coming to church. Just say, hey, I'm going to church Sunday. Marlene has put together this fantastic orchestra, and the choir's doing great. We have a wonderful time of singing. I just want you to come and share that with me. Will you do it? And they might say, no, I'm going to get up and watch Joel Osteen. Okay? But that's okay. Let them watch Joel Osteen. But you just ask the next person. Hey, guess what? We're going through a new series of sermons Sunday morning. Pastor Gray's starting a new series called Dare to Move. Won't you come with me? I'll pick you up. Are you doing that? Are you inviting people to come? Are you making contacts? We're not going to grow unless you touch people's lives. Amen. Unless you reach out to them. Amen. You see, it's all about the numbers we reach in order to get the numbers we retain. Amen. Now, saying all that, it's not just about numbers. Now, as I say in class 101, numbers are important because there's a book of the Bible called Numbers, right? Okay. If God says numbers is okay, then we can say numbers is okay. But here's our motivation. Our motivation for outreach are the Great Commandment and the Great Commission. That's what motivates us. That's why we exist as a church. And we need to remind ourselves that this is all about supernatural dependence on God to do what he's called us to do. So what did he call us to do? Well, first of all, it's a great commandment. Love God and love others. Love God and love others. Jesus said this. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. That pretty much sums up anyone's philosophy of life. If you want to have a good philosophy of life, there it is. Love God and love your neighbor. Amen. Love other people. You'll have a great life if you just do that. Mm-hmm. Okay, without any hesitations, without any different caveats or different hedges on it. Just love God and love others. and your life will be wonderful. But Jesus said that's what we need to do. These are the greatest commandments. And so we need to do the great commandment. And then Jesus said we need to make disciples. Make disciples. Jesus said, therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I've commanded you. And surely I'm with you always to the very end of the age. Here's his command to all of us, the great commission to go forward, to go out into the world, and to lead others to Jesus Christ. Make disciples. And what that means is we not only invite them to church, but we get them involved in the church so they can hear the good news of Jesus Christ and get saved. It means we go out in the highways and the byways, and the Bible says compel them to come in. Do whatever we have to reach them so they can hear the good news of Jesus Christ. Amen. And we need to make disciples and baptize them and then train them and then send them out, knowing that Christ is with us all the way. And that's why I say it's a supernatural thing. To love God, love your neighbor, and to make disciples. That's what we're all about as a church. We have to make those contacts. Amen. And so how does that happen? Well, the basic functions of the church spring up from these two commandments. What are the basic functions? Evangelism, discipleship, fellowship, ministry, missions, and worship. All of those are part of a healthy church. And if you're balanced in all those areas, you're going to be a healthy church. Amen. So we need to be reaching out. That's evangelism. We need to be training, as Jesus said. Teach them. That's discipleship. We need to have fellowship and having people come together. And then we have to have ministry, where we serve people and their needs and their hurts and their worries. And then missions is a united effort to send people to places that don't normally hear the gospel and to support them. And then it's all centered around worship, where we exalt our Lord God in heaven. Here's a graphic of that. As you see, we give glory to God, and that we do that through the power of the Holy Spirit. And then we go out and do these things, loving the Lord, loving our neighbor. Amen. And those are the different areas and functions of the church that we're involved in. All of that is the way we're to expand into this world and touch people's lives. And there's a variety of ways to do that. There's different ways we can do that. On the job, just in conversation with a person you've worked with for a long time, and they start bringing up something spiritually, talk to them about it. If they say, man, I'm really depressed. Really? That's a spiritual thing. Word depressed, spiritual. What are you depressed about? Well, I don't know, man. My teenage son is getting involved with the wrong crowd. I don't know what to do. What an opportunity to minister to that person. You see? You're at school, and the kids are talking about going to a party and doing something they shouldn't be doing. And you say, well, I won't be there, guys. Why not? Well, Jesus is Lord of my heart and life, and I don't think he'd like me doing that. You say, preacher, that takes guts. Yeah, you're right. Amen. It does. That's why I say this is supernatural. Amen. It's not something you can do on your own. You have to depend on Jesus. That's right. To learn to say no to that kind of pressure. Mm-hmm. There's all kinds of ways we can make touches and reach out to people just in our everyday walk in this world. Shane shared this Wednesday night, but Shane didn't share it last Sunday when he was in his Go Fish sermon. Shane and Vicki had moved to the new neighborhood up here in the Forest of the Unicorn, and so they decided, hey, we have a little cul-de-sac here. We're going to have a little block party and invite our neighbors to come. The head of the association heard about it, and she said, oh, you're having a block party? I've been trying to do this for years. So she advertised it in the newsletter. And by the time it was all over with, Shane and Vicki had opened up their home, and they had 60 people come through their house that day. And they had all kinds of cooking and food going on. They had people playing tag football in the street. They had kids in the backyards fishing in the fishing hole back there. The whole community came together because one person, a Christian family, said, we are going to minister to the people around us. Does that take time? Does that take effort? Does that take courage? Does that take money? Yeah. But as far as I can understand, that's what Jesus told us to do. Amen? But you say, well, I'm not like that. I'm not wired that way. That's fine. Sometimes all you have to do is be there for your neighbor. I have a neighbor and try to develop a relationship. This neighbor's never come to our church. I've tried to minister to this person over years now, and kind of standoffish, still doesn't want to break the ice. But the other day, he was out walking his dog, and we got to talking. I said, how are things going? And he said, well, not going too well, man. I said, what's going on? He said, well, my wife's going through some things now, and man, I just tell you, my marriage is not doing too well. And he opened up, and I was able to talk with him and pray with him about his marriage. You see, that's all you have to do. You have to be available for God's Spirit to use you and be there for people and minister to their needs. That's how you make contacts every day. But you have to be dependent on the Lord and lean on Him. So that's why I say a healthy church constantly looks for ways to make contact with other people. All right? But once you make those contacts, and once they get interested and they start coming, you also have to make connections. You have to make connections. That's the base point too, where you have to connect people into groups that can support them and have them make bonds with the people in that group. That's the way you develop the relationships that you make with your contacts. And so connections is base point two. And the principle behind that is this. Connected people stay. Connected people stay. When people come to our church and they connect with a group, and in some way, they don't leave. But if they come to our church just on Sunday morning, and they sit here several weeks, and they don't bond with anyone, they leave. Okay? All you got to do is watch. All you have to do is watch. That's what happens. And you go, well, where's so-and-so? I haven't seen them in a while. They're going to another church. Why are they going to another church? I don't understand that. They never connected with anyone. Amen. They never connected. And you can get all kinds of blame and say, well, they didn't do this and they didn't do that. Well, that's fine. You can blame them all they want. People do what they're going to do. But I'm going to ask you, what are you doing to get them connected? They need someone to bridge the gap from coming into these doors and bringing them into the fellowship. Amen. And that person is you. Amen. That person's you. You're the one that has to take that responsibility. You're the one that helps them make those connections. Now, I want you to see what it says here in verses 42 through 45. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to fellowship, to the breaking of bread and to prayer. Everyone was filled with awe at the many wonders and signs performed by the apostles. All the believers were together and had everything in common. They sold property and possessions to give to anyone who had need. Now, there's some key phrases in there. Notice it says they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and to the fellowship. These people not only got saved and baptized, they got connected. They were devoted to what? To teaching. They came to listen, to grow in the Word of God, and to listen to the apostles' teaching. And they were devoted to fellowship. That's support groups. Supporting one another and encouraging people. They were devoted to the breaking of bread and to prayer. They shared the Lord's Supper together. They prayed with one another. All of those things happened because they made a connection. And when they made the connection, what happened? God did miracles to the apostles. All the believers were together. And they even sold some of their possessions so they could help other people in need. Because they were connected. And they cared because they were connected. And that's why I say connected people stay. They stay and they get involved. And so we have to provide the way for them to get connected. Now, in thinking about that, we have to decide, well, you know, how do you go about doing that? Well, the best way to do that is to connect them to some kind of small group. And so this requires a process. The process of growth requires making disciples, maturing believers, and multiplying ministries. What do we mean by that? Making disciples means you win the lost and you begin to assimilate them into the church. And then you mature the believers. So in church, discipleship begins to intensify, and you teach them the deep things of God, and they continue the assimilation. And then finally, when they're assimilated, they begin to minister, and they begin to go out and reach others for Jesus. Amen. It gives them opportunities to serve and minister to others. And so as we look at that, you notice that people will stay when they connect to a small group and make lasting friendships. Some of you have been in the same small group Sunday school class for over 40 years. There's nothing wrong with that. I'm glad you have your group. The question I have is this. Is your group open to receiving others into that class? And if our groups aren't open to receiving others into that class, that closely bond, loving class, then what groups are we providing so they can bond together? You know, Edwin had the insert in there this morning about what his Sunday school class is doing. And he opened that up to everybody. Come on, I'm inviting you into my Sunday school class. So there's an open class where it's open to everybody if they want to come in. He's willing to do that. And so notice that people will connect and they'll make friendships when they get in classes like that. People will stay when they serve a common cause. So it's important to find things people can do together, different ministries they can get involved in together. And people will stay when someone cares for them. Amen. They'll come back if they know they have a safe place to go and someone listens to them and loves on them. And they're not going to get beat up here. Amen. Like the world beats up on them out there. Amen. They'll find people caring for them right here. You see, there's four ways a church can do that. We can provide corporate worship. That's one way in which we can gather believers and unbelievers together. And so our worship hour should not just be about the believers. It should also be about receiving those that have no church affiliation at all. Don't understand this church stuff. We need to be open and welcome to them. You know, we get criticism sometimes about this greeting time. It takes too much time. Listen. People in this world have no one that cares about them. Amen. Yes. And so I want the greeting time to be a time when we can really say, we care about you. We're glad you're here. Amen. I hope you enjoy yourself in our service. Amen. That's one way we can assimilate. And we need to remind ourselves of that. If you're not greeting people, then what are we doing the greeting time for? Amen. We have to invite people in and welcome them. Corporate worship's one way. We can have open groups like Sunday school classes where people can come and engage and find friendships and fellowship and relationships. And so we have a variety of Sunday school classes that are open. We have discipleship training groups. We teach them on Wednesday night. There's other classes that come up from time to time in different areas. We have our youth groups and our children's ministry. We have fellowships together. All those are ways we can bring people in to get to know each other and to grow in relationships. And we have the choir. And we can bring people into the choir or to the orchestra and have them play and be a part of that. Amen. As long as they get connected. Amen. That's what's important. Amen. So worship and open groups. And then sometimes we have closed groups. We have an AA group that meets at lunchtime over here every day. And some of our members get upset because they can't go in there during the AA time. You have to understand, it's a closed group. They're sharing secrets. They don't want everybody in the world to know what's going on there. So we have to respect that. We have closed groups too. We started this past week, Making Peace with Your Past. We had 13 people come, and they shared their secrets. And one of the things we said from the outset is, look, what we say here is confidential. No one's going to share this outside this group. You're important. We're going to listen to you and care for you and love on you. It's a closed group, and that kind of closed group's okay because it gives people an opportunity to open up and share their wounds. There's other closed groups like our strategic adult leadership training we do quarterly. This is a closed group. It's closed to our leadership. We want you to come and get skills that can help you better lead as a teacher and worker in this church. Some of our discipleship training groups are closed groups, and only a certain few can come. If you haven't taken class 101, you can't take class 201. Take 101 first. So 201's closed to you. Those are just different examples of what our church does here. And then there's ministry teams. Some people get really excited about serving on ministry teams. It's been wonderful, the response we've had to the teams going out to Grace Marketplace to feed the hungry. We had how many last time? 17, 19, something like that, went out there to serve food to the homeless. That's wonderful. But that's something that's a common cause, you see. It brings people together, and they're connected, and they're serving the homeless together. We do that with the Ronald McDonald House. We do that with the International Learning Center that we host here at the church. And we have Habitat for Humanity. We're involved in building a house with other churches and other groups. That brings us all together. These are different ways of connecting people. And so we have to provide connections. So we reach out and contact. We bring people in with connections. And that way we become a healthy church, because a healthy church helps people connect and build relationships. Now, I got to say something here. It means also that you have to engage mentally in what's going on at our church. Okay? We've done several things this summer. We had a theme all through the month of August called, Are You Living a Fully Integrated Life? Okay? And in conversation with some of our members, we bring that up and they go, What are you talking about? Well, it's only been in the bulletin for 4 weeks. And we've been talking about it on Sunday mornings and Wednesday nights. You don't understand that? No, I don't understand that. Well, what about this series of videos we just did this past week? You know, I heard something about that, but I really didn't understand what was going on. Well, we've only been talking about it for 3 weeks, and we've been trying to broadcast it and make sure you understand, and we gave you two examples, one on Sunday morning, one on Wednesday night. Amen. You can't get other people to connect if you're not connected. Amen. Don't just show up here and make your face known and then leave without ever connecting. Amen. With your brothers and sisters here. You got to connect. You got to engage. You got to be a part of the fellowship. Amen. And when you're connected, then you can get other people connected. Because you get excited, and then they can get excited too. Amen. Contact, connections. And finally, consistency. This is the unifying tip. This is what brings it all together, consistency. Consistent in our contacts, consistent in our connections. And notice what happens here in the scripture, in verses 46 and 47. Every day they continued to meet together in the temple courts. They broke bread in their homes and ate together with glad and sincere hearts, praising God and enjoying the favor of all the people. And the Lord added to their number daily those who were being saved. Now, go back here a second. Notice what it says. Notice what it talks about. Excellence breeds loyalty. Excellence breeds loyalty. People will come back to something that meets their needs, and they do it on a consistent, regular basis. People like that. They don't like confusion. They don't like things bopping around all over the place. They want something they can hang their hat on. They want something they can rest their body on. They want to make sure they can lean on it and it's not going to topple over. Excellence breeds loyalty. So regular, reliable, and stable programs create an atmosphere of trust and commitment. What's that mean? It means everything we do should be done for the glory of God. It should be done in the name of Jesus. And it should be done to the very best of our ability. Now, I'm not talking about perfection. I'm a perfectionist. But you would never know it because I excuse myself because I know I can never reach perfectionism. That's why I'm taking making peace with your past. Okay? But we are talking about excellence. Excellence means that even if you don't reach your supreme foremost goal, you're doing your very best for the glory of God. You're trying your very best. Listen. When's the last time, Sunday school teacher, you did your very best in your classroom? When's the last time, nursery worker, you did your very best caring for those babies? When's the last time that you served the Lord in a way that you know was excellent? We just love to just get by. We just love to just get by. Maybe we need to let some things go so we can focus on what we can do best and do well. You see, when people see that happening, they begin to be attracted to it and they create loyalties for it. You know, McDonald's is worried now because the millennial generation has decided McDonald's isn't cool anymore. Okay? So McDonald's, you know what they're trying to do? They're trying to create their own brand through their coffee so they can attract the millennials who like to go to coffee shops and drink coffee. So now McDonald's is going to package its own coffee so the younger generation can taste it. And then if they happen to be on the road, they see McDonald's, oh, I'm going to go by and get some McDonald's coffee. McDonald's is worried about that because McDonald's has always had loyalty. Why have they had loyalty? Because they were efficient. And you knew exactly what you could order when you went there. They didn't switch the menu around all the time. And when McDonald's tried to switch the menu around, they took a slump in sales. You know, the Big Mac might not be good for you, but at least you know you can get a Big Mac at McDonald's. They were consistent. They were reliable. They were stable. They were efficient. Okay? And most McDonald's do an excellent job of that, except this one right down the street. Okay? But that's how McDonald's created their loyalty. Coca-Cola experienced this. Coca-Cola said, we have to catch a contemporary generation. So we're going to change the formula to Coke. We're going to come up with a new Coke. How did that go? There was a backlash all over the world. This doesn't taste like Coke. And so Coca-Cola said, okay. So they went back to their old formula, and then they put the new Coke out as Coke Zero, all right? And they just took the calories out. People wanted something that was reliable and stable, something that was well done, something that they could commit to. And that's what the church has to do too. Whatever we do, we need to do it well, and we need to do it consistently, and people need to know they can depend on us, no matter what we're about doing. You see, the steady process of growth will lead to numerical growth, spiritual transformation, ministry expansion, and kingdom advance. If we're doing what God's called us to do, being a healthy church, we're going to have people start coming to church and they're going to stick. We're going to have people's lives change. They're going to have a transformation spiritually. And we're going to have them be trained so they in turn can go out and help others in Jesus' name. You see, a healthy church consistently brings people in, builds them up, trains them for service, and sends them out. Okay? That's what we need to do consistently. Over and over and over. That's what we're all about. That's why we're here. Somebody said, preacher, I don't know what you want from us. What do you want from us? Well, there it is. Amen. It's always been that way ever since I've been here. Bring them in, build them up, train them for, and send them out. Can you say that? Bring them in. Build them up. Train them for. Send them out. You ready? Bring them in. Build them up. Train them for. Send them out. Say it with me. Bring them in. Build them for. Train them for. And send them out. Bring them in. Build them up. Train them for. And send them out. That's it. That's why we're here. That's what Jesus designed. Amen. That's what the Holy Spirit wants us to do. Amen. That's what He calls you and me to do. Amen. In and through this local church. And I'm challenging you to do that with me. Let's agree together this year at Parkview Baptist Church to contact people, connect them to small groups, and consistently provide them with opportunities to be renewed and to serve. Amen? Amen? Amen. Will you do that with me? God, help us all too. Let's pray together. Father, as we close this morning, our prayer is that each of us will recommit to what you called us to do, to bring them in, to train them for, to build them up, and to send them out. Lord, I pray that by your Spirit, each one of us will commit to that, that we'll give glory to you in the process, and that people would be born again in Jesus' name. Lord, help us as a church to recapture the vision that Jesus had for His church. Help us to be on mission with you, doing what is on your heart. And Lord, may we see not only numerical growth, but spiritual transformation and people lovingly serving others in Jesus' name. In His name we pray. Amen. We're going to ask you to stand together as we sing our closing hymn. Our invitation this morning is this. If you don't know Jesus as Lord and Savior, you need to come and receive Him as Lord and Savior. And start fresh. Start fresh, day one. If you know Jesus as Lord and Savior, and you know you need to make a recommitment to do all for Him, and to follow Him, and do what He's called you to do, we invite you to come, kneel here, and just make that commitment between you and God. Will you do that? Let's all stand together as we sing.